Good morning, everyone. It was almost Giles would have had to do my presentation as well because I was also stuck in traffic. Seemingly on Thursday, the traffic is not supposed to be as bad, but for some reason, the radio says it's on Tuesday. Any case, I'm here. So today, we can just get back here. The purpose of my talk today is to actually demonstrate how we can use reflectance spectroscopy for detecting pathogen infection in MARI, Gorambia calophylla. Now, what is reflectance spectroscopy? It is the technique by which we can measure the amount of light reflected back by object into the atmosphere. So in the case of plants, it would be the unused portion of sunlight that gets reflected back by the chlorophyll pigments. What's nice about this technique, it is actually a non-invasive technique. In other words, you don't need to destroy the plant leaf to get information from it. You can actually detect biotic and abiotic stresses before it's visible to the eye because you kind of look into the leaf to see what's going on there. It requires less effort than traditional mapping, as you can fit cameras onto robots or fixed-wing aircrafts or even satellites. So you are able to map areas much broader than you actually would have been able to do by walking through the forest. But there will always be place for that. It's really widely used, especially in agriculture today. There you can see on the left-hand side, that's a drone. There are handheld devices, and then there's the AST field spec spectrometer on the right there. That's the one we use for our studies. This is a picture I took from a paper done by St. Karen. The purpose of this study was to see whether they could use reflectance spectroscopy to discriminate between leaves infected by laurel wilt. Laurel wilt is a pathogenic fungus. It affects the vascular part of the plant. And once a plant is infected by this pathogen, it actually can look as if it's freeze damaged as well. So they've used this on avocado. They've also included in the study asymptomatic infected leaves as well as healthy leaves. So from here, in this plot, you can see, I'm just going to get the cursor here. This is the reflectance on the other wavelengths on the x-axis, and that's the reflectance. And this is the visible part of the electromagnetic spectrum. This is, oh, I better get less hard on my cursors. That is the, in the middle, the near-infrared portion, and then towards the end, the shortwave infrared. So I have to get my cursor back here. So these two curves here, this one with the black dotted line, that is the symptomatic infected leaves, is the reflectance curves that they did. And the one just next to it, cursor is very sensitive, that's the freeze damaged leaves. We can see here that these two curves, they actually do differ towards this part of the electromagnetic spectrum as well as here as well. Now these two curves, this light gray one, this is the healthy leaves, and the one next to it, very closely, this is the asymptomatic leaves as well. And what we can see here towards the shortwave infrared there, that there's a differentiation as well. So in this case, the study was very effective in discriminating the four different leaves, the infected, the non-infected ones, the infected ones that was actually asymptomatic, and then as well the healthy leaves. So why did we want to use this technology on with MARI? Well, MARI has been suffering from canker disease for many, many years. Reports came in as early as the 1930s. And in 2006, Trudy Park, one of the Murdoch students as well, she identified this, the cause of this canker disease as an endemic pathogen, fungus called Gambaleria querica. It actually presents, this canker disease presents itself onto the main trunk, as you can see there on the left, or into the twigs and branches as well. And once this canker disease got hold of the tree, it seems it's not able to recover. Often we would see this picture to the right, we would see that the tree would produce kino in an attempt to combat this pathogen. Various reasons have been cited for for why an endemic pathogen has such a devastating effect on the tree, like climate change, anthropogenic disturbances, water runoff from paddocks, which would include fungicides and herbicides, and then as well root pathogens. So we decided to conduct a glasshouse trial with Murray seedlings. We decided to include Phytophthora as well because Phytophthora has been increasingly isolated from underneath cankered Murray. So we figured we will use that in our trial as well. So we set up a huge glasshouse trial. We let the seedlings grow for 18 months. We inoculated the seedlings in the roots with Phytophthora. And 8 weeks later, we inoculated them with the canker pathogen in the stems. And then what we did is we did weekly spectral measurements using this spectrometer. How this one works, it actually, it has a leaf probe. It lies here, right here. And so what would happen, we would carry the seedlings, which were heavy by this stage, to the table, and we would clip the leaf probe onto the leaf. And then we would actually, this probe would send a beam of light into the leaf, and it would actually reflect, measure the reflected light back by the leaf. So that's how we got our data here. This trial ran over 16 weeks, so we took weekly measurements. At the conclusion of the trial, we harvested the seedlings, and obviously we analyzed the data. So the first thing we did is we calculated, I think, 57 vegetation indices. Now, vegetation indices is just a small calculation we do with the reflectance data. We take the reflections, the amount of light reflected at the one wavelength, and maybe we divide or add it to another. And this is how we got to the vegetation indices. This one is the photochemical reflectance index. It's a widely used index. It's one of the oldest indexes used. And what it does, it tells us about the light use efficiency of a plant. So in this plot, we can see this, the green are the control seedlings, the red, the Phytophthora cinnamoma seedlings, the cankered seedlings, and then the brown blocks here are the dual inoculated ones, the ones with PC and canker. So this one compares the PRI measurements or the values between week 1 and between week 16. And we can see there that the reflectance measurements actually did detect some movement. The values towards the week 16, they were actually higher than before, than at the start. Now, this is actually an interesting result because one would expect that the PRI values would actually decrease as the seedlings got more unhealthy. But this can be due to a seasonal effect because the seedlings we inoculated early December, which would be early spring. So the seedlings would still be in a growth phase. And if we would have let this experiment run later, we would probably have seen a decrease in the PRI values. Now, this is the reflectance curve for the Murray seedlings infected with Phytophthora. The blue line is Phytophthora cinnamoma, the red is Phytophthora multivora, and then the control is the green line. We can see here that especially Phytophthora multivora, it actually is different from the other ones. Here in the visible area, we can see there's some discrimination, as well as especially here in the shortwave infrared. Now, the visible portion has to do with the photosynthetic components, in other words, how good photosynthesis is working. And this part here is actually, it works with the foliar dry matter and the water content. In other words, if seedlings are dying out, we will expect to see some differences here towards the end of the spectrum. This is a reflectance curve for canker. We can see there that it looks different from the Phytophthora ones. So also good, so we can try and discriminate here. And there we got a bit more discrimination here, also towards the later end of the spectrum. What we also did with the spectral data, we produced heat maps. Now this is a very cool technique, in my opinion, to actually display the correlations that the reflectances at the different wavelengths have with the treatment effects. So for Phytophthora cinnamoma, we can see that there was a better correlation with the reflectance values better correlated with the bandwidth in a visible area. As for the canker pathogen, that treatment actually better correlated with the reflectance values here towards the shortwave infrared range as well. There was a bit here as well, but we will probably, we want to investigate further, look into these areas. So to conclude, reflective spectroscopy holds potential to assess Mary health due to phytophthora canker stress. But in the case of Mary, we need to work these out the bandwidth selection to get the bandwidth specific to Mary before we can take the application to the field. But this was just an illustration to show that reflective spectroscopy can be very useful in managing forest health, because it allows us to gain information about diseases in plants before we can actually see the disease. It allows us to map disease prevalence over a wide area, because we can fit the cameras onto drones or light wing aircrafts. And so I would, I can see this technique as something to be used in health, managing forest health. Oh yes, we can use this in our native forest as well, because even though it's mixed forest, we can concentrate, focus on one specific species like Banksia in the Congan area, and we can try and map these reflectance values for Banksia, and then to see whether they're infected with Phytophthora cinnamoma, and then we can actually go and look at the other species as well. Thank you very much.